These are not dead or wounded soldiers being pulled out of the battlefield. They're alive and well, and in fact heading into combat while lying in sight torpedo shells. This is the bouncing bomb, and rumor has it, it was feared even more than a bouncing tire. Then there was the flying platform to get soldiers high up in the sky. I mean, why slide when you can fly? And why bounce when you can roll, like the wheel of death that almost killed the same admirals that were there to give the project a thumbs up? And finally, there's the first aircraft that could both hover like a chopper and fly like an airplane, except for no one dared to fly it. So here are five inventions that don't slide, bounce, fly, roll, and hover anymore. During World War II, General John O'Daniel, the commander of the 3rd Infantry Division, came up with what he thought was an ingenious idea. Torpedoes captured from Italians were cut in half and attached to form sleds to pull 12 soldiers behind a tank. O'Daniel called them battle sleds, and they were to be used to transport troops into heavily defended positions. Instead of running behind a tank, an infantry squad could accompany the tank without being exposed to small firearms, similar to the armored sleds of the Red Army, where a single sled could carry soldiers over the snow and also be used by 3 or 4 people to take cover. But O'Daniel's battle sleds had more functionality. Soldiers were pulled forward in the path made by the tank's tracks, which would eliminate the risk of stepping over anti-personnel mines. Most importantly, in an area with tall bushes, they could be transported into the battlefield without being noticed. One soldier in the front could simply pull a release wire, which would detach the sled from the tank, allowing soldiers to remain hidden until they ambushed the enemy. Even though all 360 sleds produced saw battle in 1944, there were some problems. Rough terrain and ditches made the ride impossible, and the failure of the release mechanism in some instances made the battle sleds not reliable. These issues and the introduction of armored personnel carriers forced the battle sleds to slide into history books. But why drag soldiers inside sleds on the ground when you could make them fly? In the early 1950s, the US Army was looking to develop a flying machine to be used as a reconnaissance platform, where soldiers could quickly rise up for observation and even to shoot at the enemy. But there was a problem. At the time, the US Army didn't have the required government permits to run its own aviation development programs. So the project was overseen by the US Navy's Office of Naval Research. And this is why some prototypes were marked as US Navy and some as US Army. With funding from the Army, the Hiller Aircraft Company developed VZ-1 Pawnee, which first flew in 1954. The platform's innovation was the ducts surrounding its counter-rotating propellers. The air drawn over the rim of the duct provided 40% of the aircraft thrust, with the remaining 60% created by the propellers inside. The steering was also revolutionary. The pilot could simply lean to one side or the other in order to move the platform in that direction. But after evaluations, the US Army considered the platform to be impractical as a combat vehicle. It had limited speed and could only fly with help from ground effect, which meant it could only fly so high. I think it was also a certified death trap. Easy targets for the enemy, since both the platform and the pilot were quite vulnerable to be shot at. But the VZ-1 wasn't the only vertical takeoff and landing craft with counter-rotating propellers that the US Navy was involved in. Before the invention of short takeoff and vertical takeoff aircraft, like F-35s and Harriers, the US Navy was interested in a propeller-driven fighter aircraft that could be launched from a small warship. The result of their cooperation with Convair was XFY-Pogo, a delta-wing propeller plane powered by a turboprop engine which could fly and land on its tail. It had counter-rotating propellers, so the engine wouldn't turn the airplane instead. Being an unusual experimental airplane, no pilot wanted to risk flying it. But a Convair engineer test pilot and Marine Reserve officer, Lieutenant Colonel J.F. Skeet Coleman, volunteered for the job. He had to use a special ladder to get into the cockpit, and then sit in facing the sky. Pogo's first test flight happened in August of 1954, where the airplane only took off vertically, hovered about 20 feet off the ground, and landed back on its tail. This was the first free vertical takeoff in history done by a fighter plane. But the first conversion from vertical to horizontal flight took place 3 months later, in November of that year, with over 3,000 officials watching intently. This was the first flight ever in which a pilot flew both aerodynamically and in a hover. The most difficult part was landing Pogo. Once back in vertical position, the pilot had to rely on the helicopters flying nearby as a guide to adjust his rate of descent, and had to look over his shoulder to spot his landing, which he managed to do perfectly. Around the same time, the US Air Force was also experimenting with something similar, a VTOL jet aircraft. It was called X-13, which would take off while hanging from a platform, could then switch from vertical to horizontal flight, and then hang back onto the platform. The X-13 had a maximum speed well below Mach 1, just like Pogo. With more testing, even though the concept was proven to work, it wasn't quite feasible for a variety of reasons. For instance, the pilot had to look back behind himself during landing to properly stabilize the aircraft, which could be accomplished only by the most experienced pilots. Not to mention the risks with landing Pogo on a moving ship in the middle of the ocean. On top of that, regular fighter jets had top speeds that approached Mach 2, and Pogo, with a top speed below Mach 1, was at a great disadvantage. So only 2 years after its first flight, Pogo was cancelled. But enough about American innovations. It's time for some British engineering. When it comes to launching explosives from water toward land, the Brits had a few tricks up their sleeve, and the Wheel of Death, formerly known as the Great Panjandrum, was one of them. The Great Panjandrum was made up of a pair of wheels with rockets attached to them, like a fireworks pinwheel, but loaded with 4,000 pounds of explosives. The secret weapon was to be used during D-Day, where hundreds of them would be launched from landing craft. They would then roll over water onto the beach, where they would explode upon hitting fortified German positions along the Nazis' Atlantic Wall. Luckily, before going all in, the Brits brought a couple of Panjandrums to the beach to test them out, which proved the Great Panjandrum to be completely out of control. Even though the Panjandrum could move at over 60 miles per hour, it was quite sensitive to the thrust of the rockets. Even if one rocket failed on one side, the Panjandrum would start turning in that direction, which meant it could end up anywhere, and it did. During its final test, the wheel flipped on its side, made a U-turn, and headed toward a viewing panel, where admirals and generals were sitting, forcing them to run. The Great Panjandrum never became operational, but it did go down in my books as the only thing that ever chased a dog on a beach. Which brings us to the next and final British marvel, the bouncing bomb. The invention of the bouncing bomb goes back to the beginning of World War II, when British were looking for a way to destroy enemy dams and battleships. A traditional method of destroying such targets was to use torpedoes, but underwater obstacles like torpedo nets would prevent such attacks from succeeding. So the British came up with the bouncing bomb, which was designed to bounce on the surface of water. Upon impacting the dam, the bomb would sink and explode underwater at a predetermined depth, since underwater explosions can cause much more damage than a detonation in the air. But these bombs could even bounce off the ground. In preparation for the drop, a 500 rounds per minute backspin was added to the bomb while still inside the aircraft. Spinning improved the bouncing across the water, but the backspin ensured that after hitting its target, the bouncing bomb would move back towards the surface as it sank. But dropping these bombs was very risky, since they had to be dropped about 60 feet off the surface. This put the pilots in danger, as bombs could bounce back and hit the aircraft before the pilots had enough time to move away. During Operation Chastise in 1943, the Royal Air Force used bouncing bombs to destroy two German dams and damage many more, which caused widespread flooding that killed 600 Germans and over 1,000 Soviets who were being used as forced laborers. Out of the 19 Royal Air Force aircraft that were involved in the attacks, only 11 made it back, meaning that 53 of the 133 aircrew were killed, a casualty rate of almost 40%. None of these inventions are in use today, but if you think any of these or any other old prototypes can be adapted to today's warfare, we would love to hear your comments.